The Constituent Assembly included 4 members from these chief commissioners' provinces, and they were Delhi, Ajmer, Coorg, and Baluchistan, what you call today. So 4 members were coming from these 4 chief commissioners' provinces. So if you look at all these 389 members, total 296 were elected. 292 from the governor's provinces and 4 from the chief commissioner's provinces. Total 296 members were elected. And as I said, these 93 members were nominated by the princes or kings of that region. So out of these 296 members of the Constituent Assembly who were elected, Congress party had 208 members, Muslim League had 73 members, and there were some small parties or what you call Nirdaliya, someone who is not affiliated to any party. So their number was 15. The other fact related to this composition was that the Muslims and Sikh communities were given separate electorate. And here you find what you call the seed kind of division, division on the communal basis. So Pakistan was created as a Muslim state. And you see, Sikhs were also given separate electorate rights in the Constituent Assembly. And you see, the demand of Khalistan has also found a basis here, the nasty decision of the Britishers to give a separate electorate to these two communities on the basis of their religious affiliation. We need to see that after the division of the country on the basis of the Mountbatten Plan, the total members in the Indian Constituent Assembly turned out to be 299. So you see, initially it was 389 for undivided India, but after the division, the total strength of the Constituent Assembly became 299. So this was the strength of the assembly, which was responsible for designing the Indian Constitution. And if you look at the previous experience of the Congress leaders and other Indian politicians to design any law or any constitution, remember, these were participants of the freedom struggle, right? So in a very limited way, they had experience for actually writing laws. Or so, since there was no member from Indian politicians in the Simon Commission, the commission was opposed, and this committee, what we call the Nehru Committee, undertook an assignment from the Congress party to design a constitution for India in 1928. And that was an effort or to demonstrate that the Indian politicians have competency to write their laws, to design constitution. Pandit Motilal Nehru was the chair of this committee, father of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. So this committee submitted a constitution to the Congress party, not to the government. And it was publicized in newspapers in a very great way, in fact, just to show that we are also capable enough to have to design our constitution. And you see, in the beginning of 19th century, there were some very smart British academicians arguing that, look, Indians, we are here to educate you how to rule. And we are not going to stay here, but our purpose is to civilize you, to make you a democratic nation, to make you aware of how to live a good life, etc. So that hegemonic belief was there. And if you look at the lifestyle of Indians before the Britishers came, to some extent they were right. In fact, the contribution of the British occupation is precisely this, that today we are a democratic nation. Otherwise, there were small pockets, and for some time some king ruled greater territory, and most of the time the rulers were only local rulers, right? So there was no political India in the sense we have today India. So in the history, in the whole history, if you look at the Indian history before the Mughals or Britishers came, there was no a continuous political regime occupied that much land, which you find even in undivided in the divided India. Forget about the undivided India. So this is something which is a positive outcome, we think, in terms of the British occupation. Now, there are many questions you can ponder over. Number one is that, assuming that there was no British occupation in the history of India, what could have been the fate of India today, at this moment? Or you can raise the same question regarding the Mughal occupation. If there was no Mughal occupation in the Indian subcontinent, what could have been the nature of the nation today, what we call India? So these all are speculative questions one can discuss. And so our concern is not into the speculation. Our concern is to see the facts as it is before us. So in 1928, you see the Nehru Committee demonstrated the ability that we can design laws. And remember, the people part of this committee were educated in English, and some of them were from Europe education, etc., right? So they also had that legal background, many lawyers, etc. After that, there was no organized effort to design any law, design any constitution. You see, following 1935 Act, there was an election in 1936. And in 1937, the Indian politicians formed government in different governors' provinces, right? So that was the outcome of 1935 Act, Government of India Act. From then on, you have a very active, engaged participation in the system of governance. So starting from 1937 up to 15th August, let us say 1947. So almost 10 years of period, you see, Indian politicians were very much into the system, right? And it has enriched their experience of governance, etc. So finally, when the Constituent Assembly was constituted, you find its first meeting was held on Monday, 9th December 1946. And in that particular meeting, in fact, the oath taking took place. So Dr. Sachidanand Sinha, who was the eldest member in the whole of Constituent Assembly, and he has a large experience with the Britishers regarding the system of governance. So he was elected as temporary chairman of the Constituent Assembly. And he administered oath to the members of the Constituent Assembly on 9th, 10th and 11th December. In fact, most of the members took oath on 9th and 10th December 1946. On 11th December, there was an election for the permanent chairman or the president of the Constituent Assembly. And in that election, Dr. Rajendra Prasad was unanimously elected as the president of the Constituent Assembly on 13th December 1946. Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru presented the objective resolution stating the purpose of the Constituent Assembly and the kind of India the Constituent Assembly was to conceive. So 13th December 1946 date is very important so far as the present constitution is concerned, because the objective resolution was reformulated and in the present constitution it is included as what you call preamble. So the preamble is essentially the objective resolution which was presented by Pandit Nehru on 13th December 1946 in the Constituent Assembly, and it was debated, reformulated, and a lot more discussion took place regarding the terminologies which should be part of the objective resolution, including the concept secular. That was also discussed following the discussion on the objective resolution, and it was argued that India by nature is a secular country. It is not communal country, right? And therefore there is no need to include secular term in the objective resolution. And if you are interested, you can see the debate of the Constituent Assembly, and fantastic debate you can see on these matters. So the objective resolution was the initiation of the drafting of the constitution. And the first draft was prepared under the leadership of Sir B.N. Rao, who was the advisor to the Constituent Assembly. He was the legal advisor of the Constituent Assembly. And the first draft was prepared under his leadership. He was a fantastic law expert. He was ICS officer, served long time in different capacities. He was very faithful to the regime. And he had even assignment in UK for different legal activities. So because of his vast experience in law, under his guidance and effort, the first draft was prepared and it was presented in October 1947 to the Constituent Assembly. There was a committee, you know, the drafting committee, which was chaired by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, and this committee was constituted on this day, 29th August 1947. So look at the leadership of B.N. Rao, starting from 13th December 1946 and up to this date, 29th August 1947. So this committee was constituted, but the actual work was carried out by B.N. Rao and his team. So finally, this draft was handed over to this committee, drafting committee. And then, of course, this committee worked on it and finally presented the draft in the Constituent Assembly. In order to arrive at a convincing draft, the committee surveyed almost 60 countries' constitution, the constitution of 60 countries of that time, including American Constitution, Australian Constitution, South African Constitution, German Constitution, French Constitution. So you just see all the major countries who were having written constitution were surveyed. And you know, the British Constitution is not a written constitution, but since the system was running as per the British laws, so the experience related to the British Constitution was already with the politicians. The committee submitted the draft to the president on 21st February 1948. And the president submitted it and there was discussion, and you know, after critical review, the draft was resubmitted on 26th October 1948. The draft was introduced in the assembly on 4th November 1948 for class by class consideration. Once you have any law, any bill in fact leading to any act or law, so you introduce bill. So ye jo kaha ja raha hai na, the draft was introduced in the assembly on 4th November 1948. This was in the form of a bill, right? So it was the draft of the constitution in the form of a bill, which was presented to the constituent assembly for class by class consideration, which means एक एक सेक्शन को पूरा कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट असेंबली में पढ़ा जाना था एंड देन उस पर डिस्कशन होना था, उस पर रिविजन अमेंडमेंट ये सारा जो आज भी होता है. तो उस समय तो इट वॉज ऑल बिगनिंग पॉइंट एंड द पीपल पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन द डिस्कशन वेयर फुल ऑफ नेशनल pride and they were full of national ideals. So they were participating very enthusiastically in the debates and very actively contributing to the design of the constitution. So the class by class reading generated a lot more debate in the constituent assembly. And again, if you have interest, you can just see the debates available online in 5 volumes. So you can see very systematically, article by article, section by section, things were introduced and the discussion held in the assembly. Class by class reading was carried out. Then the second reading was completed by 16th November 1949. So you see, 4th November 1948, on that date, the bill was introduced, and it is almost a year, 16th November 1949. एक साल तक ये चीज होती रही और उसमें बहुत छुट्टियां भी नहीं थी, बहुत मेहनत किया लोगों ने. तो 16th November 1949 को सेकेंड ड्राफ्ट प्रेजेंट किया गया आफ्टर हैविंग द कंसिडरेशन ऑफ ऑल द डिस्कशंस, ऑल द अमेंडमेंट्स एटसेट्रा. Some amendments were accepted, some were rejected. बहुत अच्छा डिबेट हुआ था और वो पूरा लकली सारा कंपाइल्ड है और हमारे सामने है. सो नेक्स्ट डे द थर्ड रीडिंग वॉज प्रेजेंटेड बाई डॉक्टर अम्बेडकर एंड थर्ड रीडिंग इज मेयरली वन लाइन स्टेटमेंट. द वे द फर्स्ट रीडिंग इज वन लाइन स्टेटमेंट दैट आई एम प्रेजेंटिंग दिस बिल, आई एम प्रेजेंटिंग दिस ड्राफ्ट इन द असेंबली एंड देन the class by class consideration take place. And then second reading, it is all discussion and suggestion phase. And the third reading is in fact just one line statement ki ye sab jo kuch hua, ye jo document ab tayar hua after discussion, incorporation of suggestions etc, ye isko ab pass kiya jaye. So Ambedkar bole that the constitution as settled by the assembly be passed. And there was some again general discussion on major things, because minor things were already dealt with. So major things were taken up for discussion and it was all very pleasant exchange between members with all humors etc. So the motion was adopted on 26th November 1949. 16th November को सेकेंड रीडिंग पूरा हुआ. नेक्स्ट डे दैट मीन्स 17th November को थर्ड रीडिंग के लिए प्रेजेंट कर दिया गया और फ्रॉम 17th November से 26th November के बीच में ये सब कॉमन डिस्कशंस हुए और फाइनली 26th November 1949 को जो असेंबली थी उसने Constitution के draft को approve किया. And that day, some provisions of the Constitution were implemented. Some provisions, not all. 26 November 1949. And because of that, from 2015 onwards, we are celebrating Constitution Day on 26 November every year. 26 November is the Constitution Day of India. So, which provisions were implemented on that very day? Provisions related to part 1, that is the territory of the nation, provisions related to part 2, that is the citizenship of the people, and then some provisions related to union executive, some election commission related provisions, because the idea was that we must fix that people of this region will participate in the election, and there must be a body which will conduct elections for the next parliament and other constitutional bodies. So 26th November 1949 date is very important in the history of Indian constitution, where partially the constitution was implemented. The constitution was finally signed by the members, all the members, on 24th January 1950, and the date which was appointed to implement the constitution in totality was 26 January 1950. And 26 January 1950 is, you know, another important date in the history of Indian constitution, when it was completely implemented, and we celebrate what we call Republic Day on 26 January. So the constitution as it was prepared by the Constituent Assembly included 22 chapters, what you call 22 parts of the constitution. These are legal terminologies. So chapters are called parts, 22 parts altogether, and then starting from 1 to 395 articles. These are some technical terminologies. So every part has definite number of articles. So total 395 articles and 22 parts. And today we have 12 schedules altogether in the Indian constitution. But originally on 26 January 1950, there were only 8 schedules. So you see a change here in number of schedules, but there is no change in the number of parts or articles. All the later amendments, up till now you have 104 amendments in the constitution, and these amendments were included as part of definite articles. So the number of articles remain the same, only some incorporations were made, and the incorporations were in terms of A, B, C, etc., right? For example, the right to education was included in fundamental rights section, Article 21. So it is now Article 21A. So it is part of Article 21. So it's not that amendment brings some change in the number of articles. And this is just to have some sort of feeling with the history, right? So that's the pattern adopted afterwards. And you will come to know that there are certain articles no longer part of the constitution. There is a particular part which is not part of the constitution, in fact, but still the number 22 is retained. This is the size of the Indian constitution as of now. So there were 22 parts. Part 1 relates to the territory of the Indian nation, the union and its territory. The union means Bharat. So Article 1 to 4 is part of Part 1. Then Part 2 is related to citizenship provisions, and the articles under this part is Article 5 to 11. Part 3 is related to fundamental rights, and Article 12 to 35 are included in this Part 3. Part 4 is related to the directive principles of state policy. That means we are looking for a welfare state and how the welfare state should act, what should be the objective of governance. So that is all given in the directive principles. And in this part, we have Article 36 to 51. And then we have Part 4A, and that is later incorporation in 1942 amendment, fundamental duties, and that is again included as part of Article 51. So Article 51A, and it is also part of Part 4. So we have not increased the number of parts, but we have just made some addition so that it is recognized separately, right? So Part 4A, Article 51A, is related to fundamental duties. And up to here, you see the territory and the people and what are the rights of those people, what are the activities, what are the rights of the states, and what are the duties of the people. So up to here you have the philosophy, what you call, or the tangible thing related to Bharat. Bharat ki territory kya hogi, uske log kaun honge, unke rights kya honge, aur jo sarkarein banengi wo kaise kanoon banayengi jisse in rights ko, inke welfare ko preserve kiya ja sake, aur logon ki kya kya zimmedariyan hain aapas mein aur desh ke liye. तो यहाँ तक ये हो गया. अब इसके बाद पार्ट फाइव चलता है जो बताता है कि हाउ वी आर गोइंग टू एक्ट ऑन दैट, राइट, हाउ वी आर गोइंग टू फैसिलिटेट ऑल दीज. ये जो पहले बात हुई पार्ट फोर ए तक, तो उसके लिए केंद्र सरकार बनी, राइट, द यूनियन एग्जीक्यूटिव, जो यूनियन लेवल पे जो डिफरेंट ऑर्गन्स हैं, आर्टिकल 52 to 151, different constitutional bodies, different authorities, executive authorities. Part 5 is related to that. Part 6 is related to the same with respect to the states. So who would be the people running the state affairs and how they will design laws. Look at part 7. I said part 7 was related to some kind of states originally. In fact, there were four kinds of state: state A, state B type, C type, D type, right? So because of the integration of all the princely states in the union, this part 7 became redundant, so it was all thrown out through 7th amendment in 1956. And you know, this is the year of reorganization the states, so the reorganization finally made the whole thing completely integral. So part 7 ab hai nahi hai, matlab sara kuch uska hata diya gaya, but still we have retained the number, right? So there is no change in the number of parts, we are just continuing. Fir part 8 is related to the union territories, article 239 se leke 242 tak union territory ke bare mein provisions karta hai. Then we have part 9, which is related to the local democratic bodies, the panchayats in rural areas, right? So the panchayats are the democratic bodies in the rural areas. So article 243 to 243O is all related to ye sarpanch aur unke jo adhikar hain, wo kaise unka election hoga, ye sab isme likha hai. Panchayats ke kya kya right hain, kitne subject hain, kis kis cheez ko karenge, so that is all in part 9. Then part 9A related to the local bodies in the urban areas, townships and urban areas, so the municipalities. So article 243P se leke 243ZG, bahut bade chote chote article lagaye gaye. To usme jaise aap excel file kholte ho na, ABCDZ pahunchta hai, uske baad double A shuru ho jata hai, to us sequence mein chalte chalte aapko yahan tak milega 243ZG. To fir part 9B, that is related to the constitution of different cooperative societies. Then we have part 10, which is related to the specific areas where special attention was required. So there are certain scheduled and tribal areas which are protected, its environment and the people living in that area, the flora and fauna, it is all constitutionally protected, and there are notified areas, scheduled areas, and we find the listing there in Article 244, se leke 244A. Then Part 11 talks about the relationship between the union government and the state from Article 245, say 263 in Part 11. And then Part 12 talks about different business activities, finance, property, contracts, and suits from Article 264 to 300A. That is Part 12. And Part 13 is related to trade, commerce, and intercourse between the territory of India, how we are going to have trade within the states, within the different parts of the country. So Article 301 to 307 makes provision related to these matters. Then some of you may be interested in joining civil services, the services under the union and the states. For that, there is a separate part, 14. And in this, you have all the provisions related to Union Public Service Commission, State Public Service Commissions, and how their chairman or members are appointed, what are their duties, etc., and what are these commissions supposed to do. So Article 308 se leke 323 tak ye sab jo commission hai unke bare mein baatein ki gayi. Then Part 14A is talking about certain tribunals. So aap log normally sunte hoge na, green tribunal, and then sab Narmada tribunal, ye sab tribunals jo bane hain, they are meant for some specific purposes. They are quasi judicial bodies, and they have certain judicial powers. Tribunals are significant constitutional bodies as per Part 14A. Then Part 15 talks about the provisions related to elections. So Election Commission of India and all the commissioners jo banaye jate hain, wo kaise bante hain, election hota kaise hai, what are the duties and responsibilities of the Election Commission. So that is all described from Article 324 to 329A. Fir Part 16 is related to the special provisions with respect to certain classes, certain communities, right? So that we will see, for example, Anglo-Indian community and some other communities. So Article 332, 342 relates to different classes. Part 17 is related to the language which are scheduled in Indian Constitution, official language. And you know, we just celebrated 14th September Hindi Day. So Hindi is the official language of India, as per Article 343, and there are other provisions related to languages in different usages, and how Hindi is to be promoted, that is in Article 351. So from Article 343 to 351, we find the provisions related to the language. And you know, as on date, 22 languages of our country are listed here. And the listing here has direct effect on examinations in UPSC. So listing of language in this schedule simply means that anyone can write or demand writing examination in Union Public Service Commission on those basis. So these are the significant things related to Part 17. Part 18 is related to emergency provisions. So if there is any requirement, or if there is any failure of the local government system, then the union, being the most powerful body of governance, has special rights So Article 352 to 360, they all are related to emergencies. You find national emergency, financial emergency, or what you call precedent rule, if and the state administration cannot function as per the constitutional provision. So the union can take over the state administration also. So all these things are a part of Part 18. Then Part 19 relates to so many things. In fact, if you look at all the things earlier, many of the things appear, something of this or that part from Article 361 to 367. Then Part 20 talks about how we can amend the Constitution. And in this part, there is only one article. And I think this is the only part where you have just one article, but it's very important. Article 368. So amendment of the Constitution is discussed, how amendment bill should be introduced, how and what are the requirements for passing the amendment bill in the parliament. And you know, the Constitution can be amended only by the parliament. The state governments do not have, or state assemblies do not have any direct role there. The process will be initiated there, and there are certain provisions of the Constitution where the consent of more than 50% state assemblies is also required. So we will study all these things, and I ask all of you to look into these articles and have some familiarity before we come to discussion. Then Part 21, temporary, transitional, and special provisions, and that is ranging from Article 369 to 392. And you know, Article 370 was somewhere here. It is still there. So don't think that 370 is removed. No, that article is still there. Only it is revised. Some things are changed. So they are temporary and transitional provisions that will. Part 22, which is the last, तो उसमें इस कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का जो ये शॉर्ट टाइटल क्या होगा, उसका कमेंसमेंट कब से शुरू होगा, और उसके जो ऑफिशियल लैंग्वेज है वो हिंदी, और उसके हिंदी में उसका टेक्स्ट क्या होगा, ये सब इसमें लिखा है 393 टू 395. तो इस तरह से हमारे 395 आर्टिकल्स और 22 पार्ट्स हैं.